Welcome again. Now we are starting new topic, bearings and clutches. When we are talking about bearings here, we are not meaning ball bearing as such. We are talking about a case where a shaft is supported in the support and that support is working as a bearing. So that bearing we are referring over here. So one example is, suppose I have drawn a shaft like this. And this shaft is supported here. We call this as bearing support. This is a bearing support. So the weight of the shaft is acting on the bearing like this on its radius. So if you see the side view of the bearing, then the force acting is along the radius of the bearing. The other case is when the shaft is vertical. Suppose this is a shaft, vertical shaft, and then it is having some load and it is rotating, of course. So how do we support this shaft in the form by using a bearing? So that happens like this. So this is the bearing support for a vertical shaft. So the load is acting downwards on this surface and this resting surface is working as a bearing support. Here this surface is working as a bearing support. Now we are going to talk about a bearing which is of this type. For a vertical shaft carrying a load and rotating with certain speed and certain torque, that means certain power, how much friction is exerted on the rotating shaft by this bearing surface, that is the matter of concern. We are also talking about clutches. Now bearings and clutches, they are taken together because in this case, in the case of a clutch, what is a clutch? I will draw a clutch so that we will come to know the similarity. Suppose these are the two discs. So we have got shaft 1, shaft 2. And there are discs at the end and one shaft is rotating like this. The moment you bring this shaft in contact, that means if this contact is made, then the power will get transmitted from one shaft to another through this disc. So this will also start rotating. Now when this happens, now the friction between these two is responsible for transmission of the power from one place to another. So this is the case where the friction is a desirable thing, because due to friction we are in a position to transfer the power from one shaft to another. Here again there is a friction, but this friction is undesirable. Power is going to be lost here. If you see both these cases, they are in a way same, because here also if you look at this surface, this is a case of a surface like this and another surface like this. So there are two surfaces here also and here also. So in this case there are two surfaces, here also there are two surfaces. We bring these two surfaces in contact. In this case, the moment you make the surface in contact, the power gets transmitted from here to here. In this case, when you make the, when you bring the two surfaces in contact, because this is stationary, this also will lose some power because of the friction. So here there is a loss of power, and here there is a transmission of power. So that means by bringing two discs in contact and when they have got rotation, then the power gets transmitted or it gets lost. Now which case, what we are going to consider, that is what we are going to learn in this particular topic. Therefore bearings and clutches, they are brought together. Now see on what basis we are going to work further. There are some derivations, some calculations in this particular topic. So we have to derive certain conditions, equations for certain conditions. And we are going to learn this topic in a different manner by different presentations. So unlike last time, we are using some information which is already ready-made available and trying to understand this concept. So now you can look here, introduction to pivot and collar friction. So as what was discussed earlier, same thing is shown here. This is the axial load, and because of this axial load, there is a power loss which is going to take place. In this case, the bearing surface is at right angles to the axis of rotation, which is what we have seen. Now, what happens is, for overcoming friction over here, what we have to do is, maybe we have to produce, we have to supply some more power. See, there is one example written here. To overcome this friction, an additional torque is needed to be applied on the shaft. That is, there is a loss of horsepower, that means there is a loss of power in friction. Say, one example is, suppose you require 100 HP, or rather 10 HP power to be transmitted. Or let us say the shaft is having 10 HP power. So you are, by machine, you are inputting 10 HP power. But suppose there is a friction which is resulting into loss of power by 2 HP. That means even you supply power by a power of 10 HP. So I'll draw the figure here. Suppose this is a, let's say, shaft. This shaft is supported like last time. And this shaft is of a mixer, suppose. So, and maybe there is some container, etc. over here. And this container has got some liquid. And now here, you have connected one motor. So, I have drawn one motor. And the motor shaft is, this is a motor I have drawn. The motor shaft is connected to the mixer shaft. So, when the motor shaft rotates, there is a coupling here. So, we are going to rotate this. And let's say you require 10 HP power here. So, suppose you provide 10 HP motor here. Then ideally speaking, you provide 10 HP power from motor and this requires 10 HP power, everything is fine. But in reality what happens, there is some amount of loss of power. Let us say 2 HP power is lost because of friction over here. So now what will happen, out of 10 HP, 2 HP is gone. So this will be only 8 HP left. That means for the churning purpose, only 8 HP power is available, whereas you require 10 HP. Since 2 HP is lost, now there is a shortage of power. Now under this condition, what are we supposed to do is, maybe you will have to provide 12 HP so that after a loss of 2 HP, still you can have 10 HP available here. So this is how the adjustment is carried out. So we need to know how much is going to be the loss in power. Based on that, you can modify the input power so that you will get whatever amount of power that is needed. So having understood this, this is what is explained over here. You can maybe write down after some time. Now the concept of wear. Now see what happens in this place. So if you think of this place, see what happens. When the rotary shaft comes in contact with the stationary part, which is we call it as bearing, at this place, first thing is there is going to be friction. And this friction is resulting into either power loss or power transmission. Now friction means exactly what happens. So first thing is wear will take place here. And why wear will take place? What is a wear first of all? Wear is a phenomena of removal of materials. That means because of friction, small particles will be removed from this surface. Now if I write here wear, wear is removal of material. Now this removal of material is in very very small quantity, in very very small size. That means the particles that are removed, they are of very very small size, they are not even noticeable. But in a long run you will come to know that some amount of material is removed. So that is called as a wear. Now how is this wear dependent on? Wear is dependent on what? First thing is wear is proportional to speed. So, if the speed is more, the wear is going to be more. And second thing is, wear is also related to pressure. That means if pressure is more, then also wear will be more. So, you can now, just I'll take you here. I'll read here whatever is written. Concept of wear. The phenomena of removal of material in infinitesimal quantity as a result of frictional load is called as wear. So a very small quantity of material, when it is removed, then that is called as a wear, which we have just now seen. Now this wear, rate of wear, is proportional to intensity of pressure and the velocity of rubbing. That means if what we have written just now, wear is proportional to speed, means basically rubbing velocity. And it is also proportional to the pressure. So if it is proportional to rubbing velocity and pressure, see exactly what is going to happen over here. Now I will just explain to you this fact in a different way. If you draw the top view of this contact surface, so let us say this is a contact surface, this circular surface is in contact over here, and a wear is going to take place here. Now what happens is, we say velocity of rubbing, that means the shaft is rotating. Because of the rotation of the shaft, all the different points on the shaft, they are having different velocities. So suppose this is the axis of rotation, then the point over here will be having how much velocity? The velocity at this place, suppose this is the direction of rotation and this is the angular velocity, and if the distance is r, then v is equal to r into omega, that is going to be the velocity of this point. Suppose there is a point which is nearer to the center. Now what will happen? The point is nearer, so velocity is v into r. Now r is less, so velocity of this point will be less. So one point has got more velocity. This point has got, the point which is away from center has got more velocity. The point which is nearer to center has got less velocity. Now earlier, just now we have seen that velocity is proportional to speed or velocity. Or rather, wear is proportional to rubbing velocity. That means this point, the points which are away from center, they are having more rubbing velocity. That means wear will be taking place more for the points which are away from center, and those points which are nearer to center, they will be having lesser wear. So now what happens? Wear means removal of material. So after some time, if you draw the front view, what will happen is, if this was the surface, this surface is, suppose this surface, and this is the axis of rotation. Just now we have seen the points which are away from center. These points are away from center. So wear is more here. The points which are nearer to center, the wear is less here. So after some time, what will happen is, this figure, this top surface, will look something like this. I am drawing slightly exaggerated. It is not so much. It will not be wearing so much. But then what it shows is, the points which are away, the wearing will be more here and wearing will be less here. Now what will happen is, because of this kind of shape of the top surface, which was initially flat. Now what will happen? Because there is a load, there is a vertical load all the time. So because of the vertical load, now the contact surface, the pressure will be more here and pressure will be less here because the contact is less here. Now we have already written here, wear is proportional to pressure. So now the pressure is high here, pressure is low here. So now where the wear will take place? Now the wear will take place here and not here. See, earlier wear was taking place on the outer surface. Now the wear is taking place on the center surface. So wear can take place here also. It can take place here also. Now exactly in what situation, at what time, what is happening, that is not so easy to understand. Because we don't know exactly when this is happen, when this is going to happen. But in reality, all these, both these things, they exist one after another, and we are not in a position to control or try to understand or evaluate at what point of time what is the situation. Now if this is the case, there is a wear and wear is proportional to speed and pressure, and there is going to be a situation like this, we are not sure what is happening when. So that means this wear is a complex phenomenon. So wear is a very complex affair, and it is very difficult to understand or predict what is happening. So how do we try to analyze this condition of a bearing surface? So when you start analyzing, how are we going to analyze this surface? For that, there are two theories used. So one theory is constant pressure theory. Constant pressure theory we are applying, and other is constant wear theory. So in one case, we are assuming that pressure is constant all the time and we work ahead. In the second case, we assume that wear is constant and we go ahead. So by these theories, this particular complex problem is resolved. So how do we go about? That is what we are going to learn. Before that, just read what was written here. Concept of wear, we already read this. So the rate of wear is proportional to intensity of pressure and velocity of rubbing. Pressure distribution gets altered due to varying wear condition. That means because of different variation in the wear, the pressure distribution changes. So even the coefficient of pressure is also not uniform throughout the surface. We were talking about this case earlier. Even the coefficient of pressure also may not be same everywhere. So that is why, thus neither the wear nor pressure is uniform. Hence, it is a complex phenomenon. Just now we have seen this. The problem is attended by using two different theories. One theory is uniform pressure theory, or second theory is uniform wear theory. So with these theories, we work ahead about the problem of friction at the bearings. So now we will see the next part here. Maybe you can, I'll spare some time, you can jot this down. Whatever information is written here, you can jot this down. So now let us see how do we go about. So there are types of pivots. So we already seen that we are going to talk about vertical shaft and how this is analyzed. So there is a vertical shaft, and what happens here, that is what we are going to study. But even in the vertical shaft, there are three types. So as you see here, this is a flat support or flat pivot. The second time is called as a collar pivot. So there is a collar surface here. That means the surface in contact is like a ring. Here the surface in contact is like a full circle. Here it is a ring. The third type is a conical support. So the shape of the shaft is like this, and the supporting surface has got a conical shape. So these are the three types of pivot surfaces, and we are going to learn flat pivot, collar pivot and conical pivot. Before we do that, let us see the basic theory behind this workout. So in the form of flat pivot, we will try to learn this. So one flat pivot surface is drawn. So like this case, it is drawn here. This is a circle of radius R1. The radius of the shaft is R1. So the circle is drawn in the top view of radius R1. Now there are certain assumptions. Let small p letter is indicating intensity of pressure in newtons per mm square. That means the pressure over here is small p. W is the vertical load. This W is the vertical load in newtons which is acting on the shaft. R1 is the radius of the pivot. Mu is the coefficient of friction over here. At this contact surface, coefficient of friction is mu. And T is the total moment of force from friction. So now when we go ahead, we will come to know how this is to be evaluated. So first thing is, we are considering one small element as a ring. So there is a ring which is drawn at a distance of small r, and the width of the ring is dr. Dr is small size. So this is written here as dr. Dr is the width of the strip, and the strip is, or the ring is, at a distance of r. Now what is, it is shown here by section line. So this is an elemental ring of width dr at a radius r. Now what is the area of this shaded ring? The area of this ring is going to be 2 pi r into dr. How it has come? Because 2 pi r is the circumference and dr is the thickness. That means if you make this straight, circular ring, if you make it straight, then one side is 2 pi r and the other side is dr. So 2 pi r into dr, that becomes the area of this small ring. Now there is a load acting where pressure is given as small p. Now pressure is newton per mm square. So you know pressure into area is load. So what is the load acting on this ring? Load acting on the ring is, suppose it is shown by dw, because the total load is w, small load is dw. So dw is equal to small p into area, 2 pi r dr. This area is taken here, 2 pi r dr equal to small p, and it is called as a load taken by only this ring. Now what is the total load taken here? Total load taken is, if you consider all such small rings at a time, then that is comprising the entire surface, and that is comprising the total load. That means the total load W is equal to integration of this dw. Dw is a small load. If you integrate this small load from radius r equal to 0 to radius r equal to r1. So the limits of integration are 0 to r1, and dw, if you integrate, that is going to give you the capital W, that means the main load. Now what is dw? We have just now written dw is p 2 pi r dr. So we write here p 2 pi r dr under integration sign, and integration is varying from 0 to r1. That means this variable dr is changing from 0 to r1, and the integration is going to give you the total load. So this becomes first equation, what is written into the box, dw integration from 0 to r1 equal to small p 2 pi r dr 0 to r1. This is the total load. Now see what happens because of this total load. Look here, we have, suppose, now this is a general information, all of we are aware. Suppose this is one box whose load is W. So this is a load W which is acting on the surface. On this surface, one box is kept whose weight is W. Now if you try to move this box, then what will happen is, in the opposite direction, there is a friction which will be there, and this frictional force is going to be mu into W. So mu into the load is equal to the frictional force. This we already know. Now this is applicable here. What is happening here is, there is a load here, this load is moving, so just like this load is moving, and there is a friction here. So now what is going to be the moment? We already seen earlier that this ring is carrying a load of dW. dW is the load carried by this ring. So this dW, if you multiply by mu, then that is going to be the frictional force. So if I draw tangential lines everywhere, so those tangential lines, they are representing something like this. So the frictional force is given by mu into dW. Now this frictional force is present at a distance of r. So force into distance is torque or moment. So you see here, this is dW, dW into mu into r. So dW into mu into r is the torque or the moment. So the moment or the torque acting because of the force of friction is equal to dt, which is equal to this much. Same thing is written here. So if the torque acting is this much only for small ring, what is the torque acting for the entire surface? If you want to find out, then you will have to integrate this dt. So that is done here. Total torque because of force of friction all over the surface is equal to integration of dt, and the limit of integration is from 0 to r1. So if you do that, then the equation becomes mu into dw, dw already we have found out here, into r. So if you write this again, it says mu p 2 pi r, and one more r because you have taken r twice, 2 pi r raise 1 r, and multiplied by radius is also one more r. So these 2 r becomes r squares. So mu p 2 pi r square dr, mu p 2 pi r square dr, this whole thing is under integration sign, and integration has got a limit from 0 to r1. So the torque acting on this shaft in the tangential direction T is given by this expression, and the total load which is acting on the shaft is given by this expression. So these two things which are shown in the box, they are going to be used by us for the further analysis. So total load on the shaft is given by this equation.